Hi everyone, from me Brent Graham of Good for the Game, and welcome to the Super Rugby Week 1 preview. We're coming to you live, 9 o'clock South African time on a Thursday, as opposed to the 9 o'clock Thursday night we used to. We'll also have that one later on, by the way, to talk Six Nations. But we're coming to you early, that means we can get some overseas guests on the show. And let me start by introducing the panel. And straight away, I've clicked the wrong button here, and something's happened to my screen, but there you should be able to see the guys now. It's Mossman, Nathan back with us. He's talked some URC with us and over the last few weeks. But Nathan, great to have you back on the show.
Yeah, thanks a lot. It's actually quite good to be talking at a time where we've got full team news. We know all there is to know, which is great.
I must say that's one of the things that got me most excited about doing the show, is that we would have all the team news. It's one of our big problems with URC on a Thursday night is we've got the Friday night matches, but we have to really speculate thereafter. So, yeah, looking forward to that as well. And then let's go to the top of the screen there. It's at the Crow Tips on Twitter. And Chris, you're sitting down in Cape Town at the moment. Welcome back to the show.
Yeah, thanks, Brent. It's great to be back. I'm so amped for Super Rugby again. Still my favorite tournaments, even though the Saffers aren't there, but still great to watch, great to bet on. So looking forward to it. And so be it for the rest of the few months. So much rugby on, which is going to be great. But great to be back and looking forward to chatting with Nathan on the opening weekend.
Yeah, you know, it's funny that you say, just talking about great to bet on. At Pinnacle, which is, you know, obviously where I do a lot of my betting. So they've got max limits posted, right? So you know exactly what they are. All the other leagues, URC, Top 14, you know, Prem, you name it, they'll all open at $200 New Zealand, which I think is about 2,500 Rand. Super Rugby is different. Super Rugby will open at 400, so double that number, and close at least double it as well. So I know at the end of last season, the closing number for a super game would be about 10K, which I think is about 120K in Rand. And you compare that to, as I said, one of those other leagues, you're probably looking at about $1,500. So the difference is massive. So it's still a lot of eyes on Super Rugby and a lot of liquidity in the market.
Mm. Yeah, that's interesting. And Chris, that actually was going to exactly the point I was going to make. I've picked up a lot of excitement about Super Rugby in South Africa, but without fail, every person in South Africa who's excited about Super Rugby is a sports bettor. So the recreational guy's not really that interested in Chiefs mm-hmm. Crusaders, but the South Africans who bet on sport and bet on rugby, well, they just can't get enough of it. So obviously in our sort of crowd and circle that we hang out, which is sports punters, we get a lot of guys very interested. Yeah.
That is so true. I would just quick notes. Just I think not just there's too much rugby in general. There's just too much sports in general. So I know a lot of sports fans, like 10 years, 15 years ago, just don't have the attention on some of these sports like we used to, and the excitement levels and the meaningless of those games have gone a lot out of sport, which is a pity. But yeah, as a sports punter, yeah, we don't miss a beat, do we? We love the weekends. We live for the weekends, don't we?
We can live with it. Well, just before we get into the action, Nathan, just to keep going, how are you going with your draft, your fantasy league there on this tournament? I should imagine quite a bit of excitement over there for that as well. And can guys still get involved?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, so it's all full swing. In general, the largest weekend in terms of the most number of drafts running would have been the previous weekend. That tends to be kind of ground zero in terms of the drafts. But so I'm part of three leagues. I've done two already. I've actually got one tonight at 8:30. So depending on how long this goes for, I might be auto drafting a couple of players. Hopefully not Will Jordan auto drafted in the first round.
Well, we'll understand if you look a bit distracted during the show while Chris is talking and you're busy doing your drafts. Of course, when you said tonight at 8:30, I thought, well, you've got all the time in the world, not realizing, of course, where you're sitting at. It is nighttime already. But let's get into the action. I first of all just want to touch on the outright betting. And feel free, Nathan, I'll start with you. There's been a bit of movement here. I think last time we spoke, I think the Crusaders were actually favourites, and I see the Chiefs have edged into favouritism now. But anything you fancy there at this point? And also, if there's any other long-term bets, I know a lot of the bookies price up on quite a few interesting markets. Have you got anything that you've sort of got involved with pre-tournament?
Yeah, I've been keeping an eye out for the season win bets, and they've done it in past years, but I haven't seen it so far. So either it's something they're going to post up really late, or either they've been taking such a beating on it that decided they're not going to do it anymore, because season win bets in American sports are huge. Like, you know, it occupies the entire preseason is talking about, you know, over under season wins. not seeing it at all this year, which is a bit disappointing. Not too interested in any of the pricing just around the outright winner. I think I did mention it last time, but I think if you can find a really good number on Chiefs Blues to make the final, I think that's probably a bit worth taking. Probably the only other thing, and this is more of an outside prop bet that I did see, it really only relevant to people in the TAB in New Zealand, but there was a grouping of fullbacks and you had to sort of pick who was going to be the top try scorer. And they had Shooter Stevenson at $3. And then the other guys on the list, you know, sort of Tom Wright at $6. And, you know, I think Stevenson scored 11 tries last year. And I think the next person on that list was sort of 5 or something. I'm sure he'll regress a little bit, but I think he pretty much has to get injured to not collect that bet. So I think that's a good one if you're based in New Zealand, or you can find it elsewhere.
Right. Chris, have you seen anything long-term-wise or got any long-term fancy on the tournament?
No, I was looking, but like you said, Nathan, same here, I couldn't find any major, any exotics even, just maybe to make the playoffs. I see maybe Rebels and Force are around 2-1, 3 maybe. That's interesting because I'm at the moment, I know we'll get into them, I'm in an R and whether to oppose or take or go with the Rebels this season with some of the imports they brought, but then there's a union in turmoil, so are they going to be galvanized or not? So I'm trying to, because I quite think the Force might build on what was quite a nice end to the season last season. Maybe they're going to build onto that and the Rebels might fall away. So still to discuss that with the boys, good to get your opinions, but that was about it. I mean, you're picking that the first three New Zealand teams, that's where the winner's coming from. So there's no point looking much far further than them. Who it's going to be, I don't know, but we'll see.
Yeah, and I agree with you there. Welcome to guys joining us in the live chat. Reverend coming in from New Zealand, of course, a nice convenient time for him to listen, and then Mike coming in from South Africa. I can imagine, I know, I think Mike is either retired or on his own, so he doesn't have a boss watching over him, but I can imagine if you want to listen to the show at 9 o'clock in the morning, you just nod your head a few times at the computer with your headphones on and look as busy as you can. But let's get into the matches now, Chris, and I'm going to start with you. We got the Chiefs up against the Crusaders. Current handicap I got you is Chiefs minus 6.5. There has been money for the Chiefs from what I can tell this week.
Wow.
It has shifted out a couple of weeks.
Yeah, I was even looking at this one. I was still seeing 5.5. Yeah.
Yes.
So obviously some
is 5.5 available. Just to let you know, I got my prices at PokerBet just before the show. So you know, obviously you shop around, you might get 5.5, whatever. Yeah. But definitely seems to be a bit of a push towards the Chiefs, and we got a points line here of 50.5.
Yeah, I mean, a cracking game to start. I think it was the same one last season as well, where the Chiefs surprisingly put the Crusaders away, which was quite interesting. Yeah, it's a cracking. It will be hard. Look, I'll be honest with you, it'll be hard for me to oppose the Crusaders, even with their changes. It's just always been difficult. I don't think I've hardly ever opposed them generally. I think there's, but I like, you know, if you've heard me speak before, I do like grudge matches. So I think this is also a nice grudge match for the Chiefs. I think they want to probably put the final right. And over seasons, I've seen a lot of finalists when they've played first rounds, the opposite results happen. So we're looking at this very tough call. I think for me, I still feel that line that caps too high. If I was going to play it, I'd play the plus. I can see why there's money for the Chiefs. I really can. But I'm in no mood on round one day one to oppose the Crusaders. I want to see what the Crusaders are going to be about, because you don't know. I mean, you would think there's going to be regression there for sure. And you would think the Chiefs have got a great team. They've put a great lineup there. I mean, the Crusaders have a Amua coming in, which I think is very fascinating. With Dallas McLeod, I think that's a great center pairing. But obviously, no Will Jordan's massive. I think, you know, he's one of those players that are 20-30% production in a lot of games. Okay, they didn't have him last season. And also, Crusaders, notoriously slow starters. So, yeah, I mean, you can almost take them on as they take a few weeks to get into their work. But, you know, there's no razor. It's going to be a different culture and there's different players. 50 points. Again, this. I actually made a comment on Twitter the other day, like the Australian and the New Zealand points lines are reversing on each other. And this was another one where all day, every day, I'll be over 50. I think this is also well priced. So I know I'm waffling on here about where we're going. I think it's just at the moment, it's a tight game. I have nothing strong. If I was to lean, it'll be lean on the plus. I think the Chiefs are going to win this game. I back them to win it. But I think I've called this the last three games. I still think it's 79 minutes. There's a one score game in it. And I think the Chiefs will come through. on the points, I'm going to leave the points for now. I'm not too sure. I think probably might go overs, but this game has also gone unders because it gets quite tense sometimes. So leaning on the plus, leaning on a little bit of the unders, but nothing confident right now.
Yeah, I can tell you, Henrik Swart will tell you, this will probably be a game of two halves. You'll probably get 42 points in the first half, and then it'll totally dry up. I mean, a lot of the New Zealand derbies tend to go that way. Reverend Saint Seders, no Jordan, Halfpenny, Blackadder, Burke, and Enor. And I must just did see a post on the Good for the Game forum. I think Brad Breath taking Crusaders there on the plus. Right, well, let's go to the man in New Zealand, in Blues territory is where he stays. What do you make of this one, Nathan?
Oh, clearly I'm biased, you know, based on the jersey I'm wearing in my obvious Chiefs fandom. But no, honestly, so this opened sort of two at Pinnacle and minus two, sorry, for the Chiefs at Pinnacle. And, you know, like I could not get on that fast enough, to be honest. I think so in terms of disruption to both teams. So, I mean, Richie Moanga, and I've looked at this in the past. So in games where Richie Moanga was unexpectedly out, right, so you were able to actually track the line move, the market was rating that as about 5 to 6 points on its own. So, and that would have been down to a backup who would have been, you know, maybe Fergus Burke or Brett Cameron back in the day, you know, at least someone who'd come through the system. So Revers Reihana, he's a good player and he was decent for Northland, but, you know, like it's light years of difference between him and Richie Moanga. So, you know, you're potentially talking anywhere between 5, 6, 7 points just, you know, with there. And then I think once you bring in the coaching, you know, some of the disruption just from some of the players that are out. I think overall, yes, the Chiefs have lost some experience, but I think, you know, the disruption's far more, you know, larger for the Crusaders. So, yeah, I mean, I think I would still probably take the Chiefs on the minus, even at this number, you know. And the other thing that I think, obviously, the game that stands out in people's mind is the final, and Crusaders in finals are probably a different animal. But during the regular season, Chiefs went to Christchurch, won by 21. They played again in the regular season. Chiefs won by 10. My numbers make it 10. So, yeah, I'm on the Chiefs.
Chiefs there. Nice, confident call there from Nathan. Nathan, we're going to stay with you for the next game. The Rebels plus 6.5 against the Brumbies. We've got a higher points line here. And I know points is not your game, so I'll leave that one to Chris to comment. But 56.5 points line. What do you make of this one, Nathan?
I suppose just to set it out immediately, I'm on the Rebels. This one bounced around. It actually opened 8.5, went to 7, went to 6, back to 7, and now back to 6 again. So I took it when it was at 7. I sort of debated it a little bit, and it probably for the reasons that Chris mentioned earlier, where you're sort of unsure about what the disruption, you know, going on in the background actually means for the Rebels. I think maybe it's a little bit extra motivating for them. You know, they've obviously got, you know, a point to prove about wanting to keep rugby alive in Melbourne and Victoria. The other thing when I saw the team sheet is it's a deceptively strong Rebels forward pack. Like it really is stacked with Wallabies. So they've got, you know, arguably as strong or perhaps stronger in the forwards. I like the halfback pairing more. I think Carter is better than Lalisio. I think there's a bit of bad blood between Carter and Lalisio. I don't know if you guys remember last season where, you know, Lalisio and is like, you know, who the F is Carter Gordon, you know? So
when he scored that try, I remember that, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, I think there's a point to prove there as well. But so I think at 7.5, I think for me it was clear Rebels. I'd still take the Rebels here. I think this is going to be a close game. You know, I think it could be sort of 2-4 points. But yeah, in general, I just think I like the look of the Rebels team.
Right, Chris, yourself on this game, any firm fancy on that handicap, or are you staring at that points line and considering a play?
Well, yeah, I saw some plus 8 early in the week as well, and that number was definitely a Rebels number for sure. I mean, okay, as you still, Brumbies are still very settled. They're in all dynamics. They pretty much have the Rebels number. I think I agree that the Rebels are better. I think they look a better side than they have before. But I still think they had a few weak points there where the Brumbies ultimately would always get the edge over them and ended up winning quite comfortably against them. And I just wonder that that's not going to be, I don't think it's going to be any different this time around, even though in the spot on the opening day, this is probably the spot to back the Rebels. And I think at plus 8, if you got plus 8, that's great. At plus 7, I'll probably still be on the Rebels. I think if this was in mid later in the season, we saw more form, I'd probably be leaning towards the Brumbies to see where it is. And the points, yeah, certainly like the points, because this game has brought up a lot of points. The Aussies point games are, I'm not going to pose the points yet. I'll quite keep this sentiment through the show, because look, as an overs punter, I don't know about you, Brent, rugby game, the points have gone missing. I think there's quite a few reasons for that. The game's got slower, a lot more stop starting, but I'm not yet ready to pose the not going for points in Super Rugby, because I think some defenses are premium in Super Rugby, and I think that's still going to be the case. So I think looking at overs is still going to be the right approach. I like 56. The only thing what was started to worry about 56 is there seems to be a lot of wind in Melbourne tomorrow night, and wind is almost as tricky as rain when the ball is moving about and it's a little bit humidity. So that worries me a little bit on the points, that it could get scrappy because of the wind and a bit of humidity. So I would have been looking at the plus. I wouldn't look at the cap, because I just feel Brumbies are a superior team and they could just wear the Rebels down as they fade in the second half, as like them and the Force often do. So I'll be looking at the points and looking closer to the game, what the weather conditions are really doing. Or maybe there's an in-play punt there, see how they're going.
I think you raise a good point there too, is that, you know, in general, you're betting numbers, not teams. So at 8.5, I think there's clearly a Rebels number. 7.5, I still like them. 6.5 is almost the cutoff point. Right. If you actually look at the way that scores generally land, like home teams getting within 7 is actually far more likely than 6 or so. It's just the way that and you could probably speculate on what the reason for that is. Maybe you know, home teams that are losing are kind of motivated by the crowd to try and get the bonus point. You know, I don't know, but what I do know is statistically, if you actually go and look at it, that 7.5 is a good number, and 6.5 is
yeah.
That's a good place. Exactly what Rebels is saying in this comment here as well. He's saying, I think over seven favors the Rebels and under 7 favors the Brumbies. And I'm pleased you actually explained that, because, you know, it might sound strange to a non-punter, but that bonus point line, I think, is for me the main reason. Chris, what do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. That 7 number is quite I think we all know that's quite a crucial number in rugby, right? That try score there through the 3, through the 7 is your key numbers. And just obviously just on team news, obviously Tanalipa Tupou had 2 posts there. What a signing. I don't know who's paying the guy behind their back or whatever, because there's no way they can bloody afford the guy, but he's there. And he's on the bench. And I think when you talk about I think you have more of those stats there, Nathan, than I do, but Tupou is definitely a 7-point player to any team that he plays in. So him coming off the bench will be interesting. I just know what form he's in, but when he's on form, he's massive. I just don't know where he is yet in the season, but I'm looking forward to this game. So I've enjoyed this fixture the last couple of years. It's been quite an entertaining, because it's becoming quite a grudge match as well, with like the Brumbies Reds. This is a similar type of game.
Well, we're going to get into the next game in a second, but I just want to mention tonight's show, 9:00 South African time. We got the unders taken. We got thoughts on sports to talk Six Nations Week 3. I'll also ask their opinions on Super Rugby. There is a link down in the description box below. Set yourself a reminder to join us on that show. Right, let's get into the next game. And Chris, I'm going to start with you on this one. We got the Force plus 10.5. There has been some money for them against the Hurricanes. I think there was 13.5 early in the week, and a points line here of 57.5. Hey, I'm always nervous to go overs in Perth. Tends to get
well yes, old days, yes. I was never a Force player. I hardly ever backed them. I called them, they were like the pub team of the Super Rugby. But I'll tell you what, Brent, I don't even remember, they at the back end of last season, they've got over 30 points on their run home. And the last 3 of the last 4, they got 30 points at home, and they were high scoring games. And this is the Force I have in my head. And I'm waiting to be burnt badly by these mofos when I back them against the Hurricanes, which, you know, I mean, if you look at the teams, I mean, I think Hurricanes have a strong bench, which is very interesting. Roy Gord's on the bench. They're starting with, I think it's just Puyun's getting a debut at 9. I'm always wary about debut in 9 and 10s in any game, any competition. I think that combo is so important, and I've never really seen someone come hot into a team in that position. So I actually like the Force here. I think the Force, this is an opportunity for the Force to give the Gaines a good game. I think also I don't read much into pre-friendly preseasons, but I think the Hurricanes weren't too sharp as well in the preseason. I like White and Donaldson for them. I think they've never really had a real solid world-class, or not world-class, but like very solid 9-10 that they have now. So I think that's in their favor. It's going to be very hot, like you say. And when it's very hot and dry, I think that defenses do fall off in the second half. So like I'm looking at a little different, bit of an angle here. I'm looking at a force plus on the in the first half handicap, possibly looking at that. And I certainly like the second half when Roygaard and Reyes and them come on and the defenses are hot and tired. I think the second half higher scoring is a nice angle to look at, because I think the points should be flowing in the second half when defenses get tired, it's hot, and some big guns come on for the Canes. And if you're looking for real value, go force halftime, maybe Canes full-time. That could be a quite a nice little bet if you want to look at more value there.
Yeah, I think that'll be a pretty good price. Yeah, you mentioned the force. Brendan O'Connell and myself used to call them possession merchants, because we were on overs and the force would hold the ball for like 14 minutes,
but they absolutely nowhere.
Really get distracted. I agree. They did end last season strongly. And Nathan, looking forward to seeing what your thoughts are on this one.
Yeah, this is one I'm going to stay away from. I think if you could have got the early 13.5, that was a good number on the force. At 10, I think 10, this is right where it should be. And the other thing is that, I mean, I pretty clearly remember the year that the Hurricanes won the title, they went to Canberra in round one, week one, lost by 40 points. You know, like, I think, I don't know if it's round one in general or Hurricanes in round one, but there's probably a lot of unknowns. So I'd rather see, you know, on a game like this, how they're going to turn out, you know, rather than sort of jump in at this point and find out that, you know, you're totally wrong. So
yeah, I'm that 57, I wouldn't be afraid to take on that 57, Brent. I think this curse 60. It's just one of these games I've seen. I think I've been on force against the Blues twice at home and it cleared the overs even on the first weekend. So I'm comfortable that these two defenses aren't going to hold each other. The only thing is if it gets scrappy, which it can, stop start and all that stuff. That's what, like I mentioned, which has made my overs a lot less confident as it was like 2 years ago when that was bread and butter, alt overs and Super Rugby was beautiful for me. And I'm still going to take that approach, but it just feels a little less comfortable with how the game's being played at the moment. But I'll take on that 57. I think it goes 60, over 60.
Mike coming in, Kirky saying Roygaard for a try, maybe last try. And of course, there are plenty of options available to punters. That's a beauty. If you don't fancy anything too strong on a game, you can get a guy at last try score at 12 or 14 to 1 and have an interest in that. Let's stick with you, Nathan, for the next game.
Roygaard's not starting, so first try might be a bit ambitious. Roygaard's not starting, so first try might be a bit ambitious.
Yeah. So you want to go probably last try scorer with Roygaard there. So those are the sort of bets you can get down. Now, you stay in Auckland, but you're a Chiefs supporter. Blues minus 17.5 against the Drua.
Yeah, so I think we've talked previously about the team sort of signalling their intention by some of their selections. Now, I didn't expect Rico to be playing in this game. And the fact that he is, I kind of feel like maybe the sort of the Blues mean business a little bit here. I think the Drua, like fading the Drua away and backing them at home last year was a winning strategy. That's all you had to do.
Yeah.
You didn't have to get cute. You didn't have to do a lot of analysis. Just do that and you would have won. I think you do the same here. I think Blues are actually really good in preseason. In terms of the Drua, so they've lost Caleb Munts. I think he's out with some sort of ACL injury. They had Teletia, I can't remember his name exactly, but it was playing 10 last year as well. He's gone. So I think the guy that's going to be playing fly half for them was the backup for Manawatu in the NPC. So to me, that doesn't bode well. I just think that this is one of these ones where I think the Blues could sort of name their number. Could be a bit of a cricket score. So I took the Blues at 16.5. So you know, I'm not scared of 17.5 either.
Right, Chris, nodding there. You also
in the Blues camp this week. Yeah. I'm coming hot and behind you because I know we know with the Blues, right? What they've done to us in the past. But I'll tell you what, I like the Vern Cotter effect that is there. I rate Vern Cotter. I was at a lot of Murrayfield games when he was coach of Scotland, and I've always said that the biggest mistake was letting him go. He built them to where they were. I haven't seen any progression since then. Maybe even a little bit of regression. I think this type of coach is exactly what this group of players, you've now got the experience. They're settled in the team-wise. I think Blues are in for a big season. I think, and then we're going into two games that all of last season, New Zealand teams at home against the Fijian teams, overs and team home team points all day long. You can also, I'm not scared of this cap. One of my stronger bets, this minus and Blues points. I think Blues come in strong and have a good game, start off well. I agree with Nathan there. I think they start well. I'm gonna probably be looking at, yeah. I'm expecting a better season from the Blues.
Excellent. Well, it sounds like me in past years, always optimistic that things are going to come up. I've been burnt a couple of times.
But it's now or never, right? Yeah. I mean, this team is bleeding. They've been there, they knock on the door, and now I feel that maybe that coach is the last piece of the puzzle for them to actually make a serious push and actually have them in the right mindset to go all the way. Yeah.
Sounds like a Tottenham fan.
I'm definitely not a Tottenham fan, but thanks.
But you mentioned the coach, and that always makes me think of the Undertaker, Henrik Swart. Henrik's a big follower of coaches. And also, I saw him comment on Twitter, he likes the overs line. I think it was this game that he likes the overs line on, and I wouldn't argue with that. Mm. I do agree with you, though, Chris. I think maybe Blues overs could be the way to go, yeah.
And that's probably like 17, what you're looking at, 37... 30s, it's probably high 30s. It could even get close to 40. Yeah. I think Blues will clear 40. Yeah. Easy. Not easy, but.
And talk of the devil. Should be careful. Yeah. The Undertaker says, sorry, he's a bit late. He's just woken up, Henrik. This is the first time Henrik's watched the show without a brandy and coke. At least I hope he doesn't have a brandy and coke in his hands there. But Chris, we're going to stick with you. We go on to the penultimate game of the weekend. There's been some money for the Highlanders. Quite a bit of talk that they might be a little bit better than the bookies are suggesting. We've got a handicap of minus 12.5 and a points line here of 60.5, obviously in what we know will be perfect conditions.
Yeah, no, so I'm back to back here. I'm happy to take the Highlanders. Yeah, what I've seen from them previous, well, watching the preseason, I've seen what's also their vibe there, new coaching. Interested to see some of the players that have come in. But I think they're just going to be too hard to handle for Pacifica. I mean, they I was put their heart and soul in it, but again, New Zealand at home, this type of game, I think 12 is probably a few lights. I'll probably have them at this at also at about 14, 15. It's probably a few points too light, in my opinion. And happy to take the Highlanders to put in a decent win, to start up the tournament.
Well, I haven't spoken to Nathan about this game, but I've just got a feeling that he was one of the punters who got on the early minus. Am I right, Nathan?
I've got an out that had an 8.5. So I could not be there quick enough either, and it stuck around for a while too. I was really surprised I went back for a second go. So I think it's a strange one that it's not often that wingers are sort of key players, but Jonan Ricci is actually, he's a bit of a talisman for Otago. Like when they're at their best is when he is playing. You know, he kind of really brings something. And now you've got Tava Tava Nawai on the other side.
Yeah.
I just think, it's a pretty outstanding kind of strike force they've got there. With Moana, no Christian Leofano this week. You know, that's not good. I just think this line is probably still, Chris said maybe 3-4. I think it could be even more. Like, you know, if you, you know, said they were going to win by 20, I would not be surprised at all.
Right, we're going to get on to the last game in a second. But just a reminder, if you're not subscribed to our newsletter yet, where I share my best bets, got very lucky last week, I want to say. I went under 46.5 in the Sharks game against the Stormers, and it finished on 46. I had a very nervous final 4 minutes, but there's a link down below in the subscription box. Right, let's get on to the last game. And Nathan, I'll start with you here. We got the Reds, minus 5.5 at home to the Waratahs. I guess if you talk about rugby rivalries, this is certainly one of the bigger ones as far as provincial rivalries go.
Definitely, yeah. And opened at 2.5, so there's been Rebels, Reds money, you know, come in. You're also seeing sort of 6.5 in places and also 4.5. So there is a little bit of contention about this. You find that the Waratahs are generally overhyped coming into the start of the season. Like they were backed into being favourites against the Brumbies in week one last year, which in hindsight just seems crazy, right? So... The thing is that I'm just a bit undecided about both teams. I think I prefer to sit this one out and see which team's actually sort of taken a step forward, in the off season, rather than kind of get in here, which I feel is kind of like a coin toss on this number. So to me, it's just gambling. I'll stay clear.
Gambling, geez, I sat up there. That's what I love. Just kidding. great to be able to sit out a game, and very, very important, you know, if you don't like, and I know you're a numbers man, Nathan, if something doesn't sort of show up strong, then don't feel obliged to get involved. Sit back, learn some lessons there. Now, Chris, 49.5, that's normally a points line that gets a guy like you pretty excited. But Brisbane, Warriors, Hubert, it's a little bit like backing overs in the Sharks game in a way, isn't it?
Yeah, I think this could turn into a real trench war for a game earlier if it is warm and humid there. I love this game. This is one of the games I stopped to watch because I love how they get stuck into each other. It's usually pretty hardcore. But I think, you know, considering, I've seen the hype for the Tars again, as we do. But, you know, I don't know. I think 5 points is too much, for this derby. So it's, if I'm going to be playing the, I'll be, if I'm going to play, I'm going to stay away from the points because it could be 30, it could be 60. But if I was going to play, I think a little bit of a small, low to medium punt on the +5 on the Waratahs there. I think it's too, for this game, for this fixture first up, I think it's too grudgy. It's going to get, might get, it's going to be a couple points in at either side. So I think +5, if you want to play the cap here, is pretty decent shot.
Right. Well, before we get into the best bets, I just want to ask both of you, and I'll start with you, Chris. Anything else on the weekend for you? We've obviously got the Six Nations games. If there's anything that stands out for you there, or for that matter, anything else sports betting wise on the weekend? And obviously there's nothing that's...
No. So I obviously be focused on this early, this part of the week on the Super Rugby while we had the team sheets. But I know it's Ireland. I don't know as well, but I need to fall off my chair seeing it over 20 handicap for Six Nations game. I mean, I can't pass that number up, even if it is Wales. And Wales have showed so much grunt. But then in saying that, I mean, it's Ireland, right? It's Ireland at home. I still think Ireland. Yes. I think that cap's too high. You know, I mean, on a number purely that I'm not taking the minus, not against Wales, against Italy, yeah, I would do, but not Wales. But I still think, I mean, the Irish defense is so good, so that's why the cap's in play. Irish points is a nice one to look at. I think if you can get close to 30 there, I think because Wales do let in, they're still going to let in the tries, unfortunately. Ireland are just going to be too powerful, too classy, and the tries are going to come for them. It's how much that they're going to score to close that gap. And the thing is, look how Ireland shut out Italy. I mean, Irish defense is so good. So again, it depends. Are we going to get a two game or two halves? But I think Irish points, you could be certain the Irish guy scoring like 5 tries at least.
Right, and even Irish tries could be the play. Thanks.
And also England. England. I think that Calcutta Cup. I know it's Scotland had the better, but I think that's too high. I think England are coming with a vengeance on the weekend. So I think 5. I think it's 4. I think somewhere around there. I'll be on the England plus
there for you. Yeah, that Italy, I was just saying, Italy 0 points against Ireland. The defense was...
No, you talked me into it, and then they laid an egg.
Yeah, no, that was absolutely shocking. Right, Nathan, anything for you elsewhere on the weekend? Any sporting code or the Six Nations?
Yeah, mine's probably a little bit left field. So, you know, of the 53 different rugby leagues, I bet it feels that way sometimes. The only one that has team news out is actually tomorrow morning's game in Pro D2. So I think a good bet, if you can find it, you know, a good number is Bezier. Again, I know I'm getting all these names wrong because I know that they're French. So Bezier, and I think it's Vans. That's how it's written anyway. I'm sure I'm saying it completely wrong and these Frenchmen spitting their wine and, you know, throwing baguettes at the screen right now. But but Bezier over Vans. It's lined at sort of around 15.5. I actually managed to get a 17.5 on Bet Online. But if you can get a number in that range, I think that's a good bet.
I'm just joyed to hear that you have the priority as a treat. I've been betting on the last two seasons, and the form lines there are so solid. I've been enjoying it. I haven't been punting it publicly, but I've been following it the last couple of seasons, and you can. There's some solid form lines that still hold up, and I also enjoy betting on it.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I can tell you when you know you're a victim, Nathan, if I hear you talking Varsity Cup South African Rugby, which takes place on a Monday night, then I'll know you've really fallen victim of the game. Because I can tell you, yeah, not only do you not get team news, but even if you did, you don't know who half the players is. But it doesn't stop us from punching them every Monday night.
Hey, look, if I can get the data, I'm in.
I was going to say, I bet you if we can get you some data, you'll be in there. But let's start with our, let's end the show with our best bets. Chris, I'll start with you.
Yeah, I'm going to, I've done this before previously publicly, but I do like the second half. It's in force. You can get second half high scoring. I think I saw price of 1.90, which is actually very nice for half scoring. Some can be 50-50, but you can get much lower than that sometimes. I like that value. I think it comes on and it opens up. And then I really like the New Zealand teams on the minus. That'll be my next best bet, next ones. And then all their points. And if you, whatever you wish, whatever is poison you wish to pick, either or just a strong. And then my lowest lean would be the TARS plus five. Those would be my thoughts, my leans and angles and best bet for the weekend.
Right. And just to remind you that we got the show live at 9 o'clock tonight with Thoughts on Sports and the Undertaker. There is a link down below. You can set yourself a reminder there. We're going to be talking Six Nations, but let's end the show with Nathan's best bets.
Yeah. So I've probably got a few sort of fancy things that I've already bet here, but you know, telling people about bets with numbers that doesn't exist anymore isn't really that helpful. So I'd say the things that I still think have value, and I think it's probably pretty clear, and Chris and I probably agreed on this earlier. So definitely the Blues, I still think there's some value there. And I think the best bet probably on the board is still the Highlanders.
Excellent. Well, those are the best bets. Like I said, my newsletter will be out tomorrow, probably after the first couple of Super Rugby games. So, yeah, more than likely going to be a Six Nations bet or something on Saturday. And you can subscribe to that down below. But thanks, first of all, to everyone who joined us in the live chat, whether it be at nighttime in New Zealand or Australia or in the morning in South Africa. And then thanks to the panel, Chris. Good to have you on the show. Hope you have a good weekend punting.
Yeah, thanks. You too. You too, Brent.
Excellent. Nathan, great having you back on. Looking forward to talking to you throughout the Super Rugby season as well. And all of the best with your draft, man. Hope things go your way this weekend.
Thank you. It's literally going on now. So if I seem a bit distracted, that's why. It's happening on the other screen.
We're only just over half now, so you can at least get on, hopefully, for your second pick. Thanks, everyone, for joining us for the Super Rugby preview. And we'll see you tonight, actually, at 9 o'clock for the Handicap Rugby Chat That Matters.